I'm not sure why Tate Matunja did this to me, but thank you very much for inviting me. This is a very heavy moment in our country when we have to remember an incident like this. Usually at memorial lectures, they would name a memorial lecture after somebody, so they'll say, O.R. Tambo, you know who they are talking about. When you say Marikana Memorial Lecture, what may be missing is that we are talking about people who lost their lives. And I want us to start by paying a small tribute to them by all standing up. Let's all stand up. And we're going to pay tribute to all of the people who passed away. You can start the music there. Marikana is like looking into an open grave, yet to be closed, because the wound still stands agape 10 years on. The stench of the blood remains. This open grave that no one wants to close, only one cop has been thrown under the bus when so many have not been made to account. Where is the justice? Where is the accountability? This is an open grave. An open grave that exposed the crude slavery of our modern day. The crude slavery of our times. What an open grave. Exposed the hatred for change, the hatred for transformation of our economy, the hatred for compassion. It exposed the absence of consequence. Oh, this is an open grave. It has buried all sense of freedom. And maybe one day, those that occasion this tragedy will be men enough to stand like men at the side of a grave and give the families closure and have the courage to close this grave. What a wound still gushing. This is an open grave. I want us to remember those who passed away, not just as people who died at Marikana, but as names of people. Tembinkosi Gwelani, Patrick Jijase, Jackson Lehupa, Raphael Liao, Mafokisi Mabia, Tokoti Mangotwa, Anele Mdizeni, Bongani Mzee, Telani Mohai, Tabiso Johannes Mosebetsani, Tobile Mpumza, Babalo Mchazi, Michael Ngwei, Mpumzeni Ngande, Rest in peace. Ntandazo Nkamba. Mteni no ki. Bongani Ngonto Pele. Bongezeli Nchenchwa. Andris Nchecho. Mulifi Ntswele. Henry Pato. Fezile Sipendu. Mzukisi Sompeta. Tabiso Telejani. Mpangeli Tukuza. Nkonsiyabo Alabile. Robala Kakoto. Tepsile Yawa. Bonginkosi Yona. Tobisile Zibambele. John Kutlano Ludingwane. Robalang Kakagiso. We can all sit down. May their souls rest in peace. These are real people, real families, and for the members of the families who are here, would like to say we are with you in this pain that continues, because the gap that these gallant fighters left probably still remains. MC, I got a long speech. I'm not sure how long I have. The president said I should take as long as I need to finish. But I'll try not to be too long so you don't fall asleep while I'm talking. But they said it's a lecture. So, you know, a lecture is a lecture. Usually in the lecture, people will not ask questions. They'll just say amen at the end. Yeah, you know, but the speech will be available for those who sleep halfway, so you can see the parts that were said while you were sleeping. Fortunately, I wasn't given a particular topic, so I decided, let me just reflect on what this Marikana massacre means. First of all, when we're saying a memorial lecture, we must remember these people who have passed away. That's why I made a point to say, let's read all of their names, so we remember them. When the majority of black people went to the post in 1994, they expected a better life for all. And I think after 30 years, after Mandela walked out of prison, we realized that hey, this was all but empty promise. As empty a promise as it is written in the Freedom Charter that the people shall govern and the people shall share in the country's wealth. I think those are the two big unkept promises. That the people shall govern because the people are not governing, but it's the politicians and the greedy capitalists that are governing. They have managed to form what one can only describe as an axis of evil. The conspiracy between public and private sector is what was exposed at Marikana. Because it is in that moment that we realize that the promise for governing, that the people shall govern, was a big blue lie. That in fact the people are not governing. And some are using the name of the people to govern for themselves and for their own self-aggrandizement. And nothing else. No one foresaw that in 21 years, after that democracy, after that vote where we queued for hours to cast that vote, no one could foresee that an old age apartheid brutality by the security forces would resurface in what has happened in Marikana. Nobody could predict that. Right? And it's not because it never happened in Sharpeville or in Soweto. But people thought that because it's a democratic government, such a thing would not repeat. When the democratic government refused to give the Dalai Lama a visa to come and celebrate the 80th birthday of Desmond Tutu, Desmond Tutu warned to say, I am warning you, ANC government, because we will pray for your downfall. I'm not sure whether before he died, did he pray for it or not. If he didn't, we should join him in praying for that downfall, because that downfall would maybe give us a chance for a promise of a better life for all to be fulfilled. And the promise that the Freedom Charter made, that the people shall govern, maybe will be realized if the downfall of something that has been in place for 30 years can happen. Tutu said in that context, yeah, I think we must clap for that one, yeah. Tutu said in that context, right, that with the apartheid government, you expected it. When the Sharpeville massacre happened, Langa massacre happened, all of this, during those days, you expected that, because you had a brutal government that sought to oppress, not to free its people. So, with Marigana, you didn't expect that of a democratic government. The tragedy brought into the picture and the center stage the ambiguities of this democratic order and its contradictions. There's a book that is entitled Speak Left or Talk Left, right, and Walk Right. So you speak all of the democratic speak. You speak all of the good policies, all of the wonderful empowerment policies. They're all in the books. In fact, the first big promise, and therefore that is becoming a lie to many people, is the Constitution itself. That talks about equality. That talks about the empowerment of people, the uplifting of lives. And then they walk right. They walk right with incidents like Marigana, where you ask for a paltry 12,500 and they shoot you. And this is not an exaggeration, and say, oh, this guy's hyperbole. It's not an exaggeration. The Marigana thing was a big conspiracy. A man who is on the board of Lonmin and is now our president makes a call to a government, to his comrades in government, and say, hey, can you please shoot and kill these people? But no, he didn't actually say that. Okay, what is your interpretation of, please, can you take concomitant action? What does that mean? In simple English, it means what? Concomitant. It's a big word. Eh? I've only heard it being used in many contexts. Concomitant. It means that do to them what they're trying to do to us. They're trying to bring us down. They're trying to make us part with our precious 12,000. Kill them. I don't care what Falam Commission said, that no, he wasn't actually so guilty. The problem in this country is that we don't call things by their names. We dilly-dally around the things that we're supposed to call by their real names. This was a conspiracy between a greedy businessman on behalf of a greedy capital company that we have been told he has been stealing money and putting it abroad. I didn't have to say it. There was a full lecture on it earlier. And a government that is tone deaf. In Setswana, what was Nansebe? Tone deaf. That's how the government, how about Utwini? That's why we have to shout. But no, I don't shout on TV. There's something wrong with the volume. Because they don't hear. They thought it was all right to listen to their comrade, billionaire, right? Who, by the way, has so much money that he can play with it and buy buffaloes and strange cows. Right? Listen to him who says, take concomitant action against these workers who want 12,000 rand. And 10 years later, he has not said sorry. He's been too proud to say sorry. He's been too proud to humble himself and go to Marikana, where these 37 people were murdered by a government of his comrades, to say, I am sorry. No, please. He's the only hope we've got. Please don't criticize Ramaphosa. You know what I said? I'm coming to talk about, hey, are you going to criticize Cyril? No, I don't care about criticizing Cyril. I'm saying to you, Marikana is a clear demonstration of a conspiracy between a government that's supposed to care and a capitalist private sector that will never care. And everybody like a CSI, but yeah, CSI, they are CSI, wait. But that 10 rand out of millions, by a fang, as bones like to a dog. That is how capital is behaving. And it's aided by a tone-deaf government. And Dudu said, but you know, with apartheid government, you expected it. Not with this regime. We expect better. We expect some compassion. But did we get it? No. Did we learn anything after 10 years? I doubt. As we'll talk about that just now. This is a government that profoundly rich with contradictions. That in a country and in the region, rich with the most precious metals exported to the world over, there people have died for a paltry 12,000. I don't know what it is in dollars. What is 12,500 in dollars? Less than 1,000. People will laugh at us. I think the world would laugh that how these people, they export these minerals, gold, platinum, you name it, all over the world. And then people manufacture them. They beneficiate them there and then sell it back to us more expensively. And then we kill our people for $800 because all they wanted was they should just have just a share of the wealth as promised by the Freedom Charter, as promised by the Constitution, that the people shall share in the country's wealth. Not much sharing is going on. If anything, we have been betrayed and we have had only a share of tears of kids who must grow up without their fathers because somebody, some comrade somewhere thought, hey, I must respond to this email and just create concomitant action. Because who are these workers who want so much money? Meanwhile, dollars are in my mattress. That's what makes me more angry. That President Ramaphosa has not parted with 1 cent to comfort the victims of Marikana. But maybe we're expecting too much. Because he couldn't part with a few cents to pay his own workers at the ANC headquarters when money was in his mattress. It shows you the kind of low we have sunk to. And we think this is the best we've got. And of course, it may just well be, because if you remove him, who's going to be president? Your guess is as good as mine. I don't know whether I'm ready to live under Didi Mabuza or Ace Magashule as president. But the ANC have cast us a terrible die. And what irritates me even more is that at the graveside of Winnie Mandela, he promised to say, I'm going to go to Marikana. I'm going to go with Julius Malema. I'm going to go there. It's 4 years. I don't know how long it takes. It's been 10 years since Marikana. It's 4 years since he woke up and said, at the graveside of Winnie Mandela, I will go with Julius Malema to Marikana to say to those people there, I am sorry. He didn't bother. All he did was to lie to us once again. And today I was told, 10 years now, the Solicitor General at the GCIS, I don't know what he said because we're here, that he's only given an update of people, how people have been paid or not paid in Marikana. This is the kind of government. It will take 10 years to pay. I think the balance must be maybe a paltry 10 million rand. And when I say the government that walks right but talks left, these ones have perfected that art. The Auditor General reports that every year there's upwards of 40, 50, 60 billion rand of wasted expenditure. In simple English, buhodu, bobu equal to 40 billion rand every year by municipalities. They couldn't take 10 million of that and give to people they killed at Marikana. It would not even dent the bank balance of even a municipality. The poorest one, Baba Hani Stadium, 15 million, take a ring, playground. This is where we are. These contradictions are real. Right? But why hasn't Cyril Ramaphosa said sorry? It's because he's surrounded by people who are not sorry. They are not sorry. You are just too much trouble making noise for them about Marikana, about what happened there. They actually are not sorry. They are laughing. A year ago, I invited the Minister of Social Development to my show on ENCA called Power to Truth and said, Minister, it's 9 years. Why haven't you paid the widows? Why have you left the widows unattended to? Why has government not done anything for the widows? She says, you know, she's one of my favorite ministers, Ambassador Zulu. You know, she says, no. In a week, I'll sort out the widows. I'm not exaggerating. He says, in a week, not in a week, I'll be here, I'll be back to report back. It's a year. She has not come back to report back. She has not done anything for those widows in that week. I doubt she did anything. Because all I was asking is, let's forget about these big payments and so on. What is the social development doing for the widow? I'm sure a lot of people have done things for the widow. I was just asking about social development. So she admitted that nothing has happened, but in a week, she'll be back to report. I bumped into her 3 weeks ago and said, hey, minister, when are you coming to my show? You know the first question, Musne. What happened to that week? And she's one of the big advisors of the president. If she has, the president has advisors like that, it is no surprise that he has not said sorry after 10 years of the massacre of Marikana. Unfortunately, Marikana reminded us that apartheid as a policy may be dead and buried, but the capitalist monster remains. And we need to ask ourselves the question, what are we going to do about it? Under normal circumstances, we would say, here we can go to the refuge of government and say, please help us to fight back if the capitalists are being rude to us or they are being greedy and what have you. But once again, I want to go back to say, this betrayal that we are talking about here today is a conspiracy that continues to oppress the working class. And that conspiracy, unfortunately, at the helm of it is our own government and then capital. Take a look at what is happening in Krugersdorp. The so-called Zamazama, so people come in and they have to mine illegally because of whatever reason. And the government has turned a blind eye to that. They are now running because now 8 women have been raped and now they are running around and so on. They have arrested 350 people. Can you believe it? They arrested 350 people in the last week or two. So I asked the minister yesterday, so where were these people who have been doing criminal activities for 10 years and you only have arrested them? If 350 people can be arrested, it means there's a huge criminal network that's happening. No, it's not because of not doing anything. I've known this since I was commissioner in 2010. No irony befalls him. He says he's known about the Zamazama since 2010. It's 2022. And then he argues with the community in the studio that says, but we don't see visibility of police. He says, no. There are 12 police in that area, 12. They have arrested 350 people. But there are 12, I don't even know how this police did it. Why am I saying this is a conspiracy of betrayal? They're mining houses, and I've got no time for the mining industry, by the way. And I was talking to your colleagues who work there. Sorry you work there, but got no time for it. It's a very cruel industry. What Marikana did was to expose things that we thought were sorted out in 2013. I used to work for the Chamber of Mines. For my sins. By the way, I don't know whether you knew this, but I used to work there. Because you hate the Chamber of Mines with a passion. they've just changed their name, not their habits. They changed, they are now called Minerals Council. Okay? I worked there, so I know they can't tell me anything. I know exactly what they, how they are like. I walked into a meeting of the Chamber of Mines where 20 or 25 CEOs are represented. And you felt like this was in 1980. The language there about the democratic government and the democratic future was sounded like 1980. I'm not joking with you. That's why I'm thinking here, things that happened in Marikana were supposed to be sorted in 2013 because that's where they talked about what was called mining royalties. And they were very, very angry. They were saying, yarr. Just the only thing I didn't say is this kafirs. What do they think they are? That's the only thing that they didn't say. But they said it in as they say, they voted with their feet. Because 50 billion rand left these shores. The same way that we were talking about illicit. This was not illicit. This was in broad daylight there in the JS. People migrated to go and list in other stock exchanges. 50 billion rand capital by merely the Minister of Minerals in those days, Phumzile Mlambo-Ngcuka, saying 50% of these minerals must belong to South Africans. Those, the members of that chamber migrated 50 billion rand overnight rather than pay royalties to a black government. Today, they talk here in nice language here about safety in mines. And they think we forgot that they migrated. Before even the law was written, by mere suggestion that, by the way, these minerals belong to South Africans, can 50% of it, which is also very generous, because you are saying half can just belong to anybody else, but the half can, please, half belong to us. No, 50 billion, let's go. These people are mad. The mining industry, I have no time for them. And they show their true colors in Marikana with people living in what was equal to pigsties as accommodation. And we were shocked. I mean, I remember Bishop Seoka was beside himself when he could see the living conditions of people. I'm not talking about 12,000 yet. I'm just talking about treating people like human beings. If our government has a match in tone deaf, it's in the mining industry. That's why Froneman can pay himself 300 million without flinching and think it's okay, it's my shares, Moose. What's your problem? And then says to you, no, you can't get 1,000. And no sense of shame in that regard. But tell me, how is it different from government who have reneged from a 3-year deal with its workers and even were prepared to go to the constitutional court to say no to workers who are paid pittance? Government workers must be the most patient people I know, who when they receive their pay slips, it's minus. Because after all the deductions, and then now with fuel costs and so on, and the high cost of living, it actually is not worth it to go to work. They earn in order to go to work. You know, your take home is 2,000, and your transport is 3,000. So now you are always on a deficit. You need an overdraft to work for government. Sacrifice, Moose. That is what Marikana has told us. It has shown us we are in deep, deep trouble. And this is 10 years ago. And those things could be said today about Alexander, about Krugersdorp, about Tembisa, another Marikana they're brewing. In Tembisa, just 2 weeks ago, 4 people were killed there in a protest. And then you tell me, you think you have learned something from Marikana? Have you learned that police must be able to control the crowds in a particular way that shows that we are in a democracy? We haven't learned that. There's no lesson taken. If anything, things seem to be getting from bad to worse. Marikana, that's why we call it an open grave, because we are still standing there looking, right, at the result of that massacre, a deteriorating economy, a government that doesn't listen, promises that have been broken, lies that said you will govern when you can't, you don't, lies that you will share in the people's wealth, and we don't. Why has this government not demonstrated that they are sorry? They are in what is called a tripartite alliance. Another excess of evil. Because here are people who pretend during the day that they are the vanguard of workers, and at night, they are the elites who eat at the table with the master. It cannot work. You've got to choose your struggle. Are you a vanguard of the workers who will make sure that workers in the future don't get murdered for asking for a pay increase? Or do you have to mollycoddle and speak nicely so that you can get a cabinet position as a member of COSATU or a member of the SACP? You've got to choose your struggle. And the tripartite alliance has chosen his struggle. His struggle is to be at the table of the master. You have chosen it very clearly. If you doubt it and so on, you know the Bible says, let those with eyes to see, and those with ears hear. If we can't see that this again is another additional layer of conspiracy where people lie to us to say, oh, well, you're a vanguard, and then go and eat at the table of the master, then we have ourselves to blame. And I think South Africans have a lot of blame to carry, because after 30 years, we still go to the polls and vote for the same people. And say, hi, maybe they'll improve, why is it? Hi, this time, let's give them one more chance, man. Maybe they'll just this once, they'll improve. There's a place in the Northwest. Now, this one irritates me. I think the place called Swaying. I may be wrong about the name. I've never seen a horrible place like that. Sewage is flowing to the graves. It means even if you are dead, you still feel the incompetence of these people. I mean, I can imagine sewage flowing anyway, but to the grave. And then they go and vote. 63% of that community vote the ANC back into power. But what can we do? And then they go to an imbizo to say to the president, yeah, there are potholes in Mawatu, man, there are potholes. And I want to say, hey, you're a little pothole, man. The joke is on us. Marikana, I've got bad news for you. It will happen again and again unless we do something about it. It's a sad thing to say, but what do people in the families in Tembisa think? Maybe what did they think a month ago? Maybe they thought it will never happen to them. It happened far away in the northwest town of Marigan. Can't happen here. This is Tembisa, Momabone. And then four people die. The place looks like it looks like when we had a state of emergency in 1986. That's how it looks. It looks like a war zone. Tembisa, just here. Because somehow the people there maybe thought it don't happen to them. It will happen far away, somewhere in Kolobeni, there, when Kwede Mandeje tells the people to go away. They think, oh, it's even in Kolobeni. Here it don't happen. It don't happen here in Krugersdorp. It's happening again and again because we have not taken lessons from the tragedy of Marikana. We've got a government that is tone deaf. We've got business that continues with its greed unabated. So what must we do? The only solution we have here, thank you very much, is an uprising. I hear Mbeki says, hey, there may be an uprising of Arab Spring. he talks like he was not there, man. You know? You know, he talks like he wasn't there. He was there. And he was one of the first people who, I think it was 2012, if I'm not mistaken, he said, there's a need for a new cadre. The NCC talked about that new cadre after 20 years. There's no new cadre emerging. You got to replace the current cadre and put in place people who care about the people. Unless there's an uprising in this country, I'm telling you that our children will still be talking about Marikana. This term to be maybe 30 years Marikana commemoration. And their conditions would not have changed. So I'm glad that it's Mbeki who raised the issue that there can't be so many people unemployed. You are going to have an uprising. In fact, you should have said there must be an uprising. Not say ANC must do something to avoid it. It's too late. Labor will happen after 30 years. If after 30 years you couldn't get something right. It's like somebody who's been a minister like Jeff Kadew for 25 years and still wanted to be a minister for another 5 years. What are you going to do that you couldn't do in 25 years? Head over 5 more years. When our education system is in utter total collapse, a minister of education has been there for 15 years in succession. I get to the retirement age in 15 years. I mean, what new idea can you tell me after 15 years? There's no way, man. There's no, you can't. You understand? The brain has a particular capacity. At some point, it gets saturated. You cannot give me a new idea after you've been doing the same job for 15 years. I'm sorry. We're meeting Wachi. We didn't even watch a long service. You need a proper uprising. And this AMCU, right, that made sure that workers get what they deserve, both in 2012 and recently, where you made sure that you can get some crumbs from Froneman's salary of 300 million for your workers, you are the leaders of that uprising. There's no alternative. We've got no alternative but to revolt at kids drowning in toilets. We've got no alternative but to revolt at women being gang raped when police deny that they are not visible, or that they deny that they are not visible, when the community says, we see it every day that you are not there. There's no alternative but to revolt. If we are to pay proper tribute to those who perished in Marikana, we can't sit around and fiddle while Rome burns. And AMCU is on your desk now. What are you going to do? Right? The unions in this country represent less than 30% of the workers. That should tell you something about whether or not workers even have confidence in unions. Good for you that you broke away and form the union that at least people can look up to as something that can cause a revolution. Well, maybe I'll be arrested for being called an instigator, but I'm calling for a revolt against the current conditions that our people have to live under. How can we not have a revolt? I don't understand. When sewage is flowing into your ancestors' graves, what else do you need to see happen before you revolt? Must it be your cousin, your daughter, your wife, who's gang raped first before you revolt? I don't understand why there is no insurrection in this country. That I don't understand. It's because our leaders have become so complacent. They think that because they've got 18 million people that they have put on social grants, those people are beholden to them. And so they can do pretty much as they please. Because in a democratic place, after the massacre of Marikana, Lonmin should have lost his license. Why didn't they lose their license? No, now they get to sell to somebody else and change their name and call themselves Sibanye or whatever. Okay, they corrected me. They said, no, they're not lawmen at all. They fired everybody. But it's because lawmen, right, got away scot-free. They were not even supposed to be able to sell anything to anybody. They were supposed to lose their license because 37 people were killed unjustly. Aye, but they've got the government on their corner that could not be bothered. And people think, oh, no, these people are negative. They're always, I mean, what must we do? I always say to people, just give me something to hold on to that will give me hope. I'm a prisoner of hope. I think that maybe one day the ANC of Oliver Tambo will rise from the ashes. I'm just a prisoner of hope. But all the evidence points to the fact that we must forget, that we must create our own alternative way of governing ourselves if we are going to get this country right. That's all that we are going to have to do. A revolt is no longer a luxury. I don't know what you're going to do to create that revolt. The reason I raise the fact that only 30% is that within even this 30%, the unions are not united themselves. Workers are not united. Because some of them are so deep in the pockets of the ruling party, they don't even see the woods for the trees. It's actually very sad. The toxic combination of private capital and government is one of the worst tragedies, worse than Marigan. Three miners are trapped in a mine for how long now? 1,500 days. Now, if Froleman, one bright day, decided to go down the shaft of Sibanye to go and see, I don't know why the CEOs do that, and God forbid something happened, then the shaft sort of sank or something, I can tell you now, the mining industry will mobilize the 120 million to dig him out of that hole. They will not say it's expensive. They won't say it's not profitable. They won't speak like Gwere Mandashe saying, oh, no, you need an investor. You know, we can't take out these bodies. You need an investor to do this. These are, after all, three black lives. You think the mining industry cares? Do you know that Froleman alone can dig up those miners and still not feel a balance? The banker will call him and say, we see there's 120 million that's left to our account. He says, oh, okay. Because that's what you need. Then you need 120 million to dig up those three bodies to give the families closure. Lily Mine, another open grave. The families are camping outside that mining. What do the Mine Minerals Council discuss when they meet? If they don't say, but what is happening there that is giving our mining industry a bad name? Let's go and dig up those bodies and give the families closure. They don't. They don't care. That's why I'm saying you've learned nothing from Marigana. Because the Lily Mine incident happened way after Marigana, isn't it? If we had a little bit of a prick in our conscience who say, we can't have another set of people dying in the name of the mining industry, guys, come on. Let's gazard. You know, there's a phrase called gazard. The 20 CEOs who sit in the mining, minerals council, they can gazard from their own money. Not money from a government. From all these bonuses, the obscene bonuses they get, they can gazard money that they won't feel. They'll die without spending that money. But it shows you that the black lives don't matter. As long as they dig up the gold and then they go and die at their homelands with silicosis and other diseases you get when you are mining, the bosses are smiling all the way to the bank, and they will do so because they've got a government that will not even so much as write the letter of reprimand to them. They sign what is called social compact, or I don't know what it's called, the social compact, social development or whatever, agreement that is linked to their license. As we speak, there are 6,000 abandoned mines, and those mining companies have gone on
to mine somewhere else, when those communities are now suffering the result of those mines becoming caves for thieves and criminals who rape their daughters and steal from them and all of these things. And those miners, they are mining happily. All is going on, is business as usual. Government couldn't care. They know that this is a toothless government. They don't tell them, but we're gonna cancel your license if you don't rehabilitate those mines. What should happen first before there's a revolution in this country? Amku, I'm putting that challenge to you. It's not good enough to just march and so on and so on when your workers are involved or where you want a 2 rand or 1,000 salary increase. We got to say, we got to fix the country now. We have to fix the country. I'm putting you a challenge for you to reach out, and I've seen you started doing it. Reach out to your other fellow unions in the country. These ones who are in the deep in the pockets of the ends, take them out of their pocket. You are the only ones who can sniff them out. I don't know whether you remember that when a Jay Naidu sneezed, the country came to a standstill. And he says, no, we're gonna, there's going to be a stay away. Right now, when you say stay away, people laugh at you. You say, hey, stay away for what? Because it's going to be no work, no pay. It means that the unions and the power that they've held has lost its sting. And so what you've done, both in leading the Marikana strike and the recent one, is to show that something can be done. And the unity which you've shown on the 1st of May, where you pointed the middle finger at the president and his mealy-mouthed policies, is a good start, but it is a weak start. We've got to bring the place to a standstill and have a revolution in this country on behalf of those who perished at Marikana. I want to conclude by talking about the brutality of our police. It's an issue that we cannot take for granted because it's directly linked to this revolution. Because if you try to do a revolution and you haven't sorted out how the police behave, we're going to have another Marikana. Because they're going to try and use brute force to silence you and say, you can't do this. You can't protest here. By the way, the constitution, we can leave here to go and protest in something. No, nobody. It's in the constitution. You don't even have to ask for permission. Right? You can inform the police, listen, I'm gonna march here. Please, can you close that road and so on. Not, oh, can we decide whether you can march or not? Actually, the constitution is quite clear about it. Right? I hope I won't be arrested for being an instigator. But I am instigating you to say, you got to revolt now. If you don't, you will regret. Right? Generations will ask, what did these people do? It's unbelievable. They think they are reading fiction. When they hear, right, that during COVID, a minister had a criminal record because they decided to defy the very laws they put in place, and that person was sent back to cabinet. They'll think they'll say, no, this is fake news. They'll say it's not possible. Or the Minister of Social Development, who made a promise that he'll come back in a week to sort out the victims of their own doing, where they killed their husbands. And the same minister is seen shopping during COVID when everybody else was told to stay at home, they'll think this is fake news. It can't be. They'll say, no, it cannot, it's not true. When they hear that the government or the workers of OR Tambo's movement could not be paid salaries for months, yet the president who's filling the shoes or attempting or pretending to fill the shoes of OR Tambo had money in a matras, in dollars, that could have paid those people for. They'll say, no, this is fiction. They'll say, this is fiction. They really will argue with, and they won't be there to say, no, it's not fiction, it was actually true. But what will surprise them, and where they think is further fiction, is that there was no revolt. There was no revolt. Instead, people went back to vote for the same people 30 years on. Election in and election out. They'll say, no, these people's conscience were dead. That's the challenge we have today. As we look back after 10 years, and as we pay tribute to those who fell in front of a democratic government that was supposed to know better, do better, we have to do something. And we have to do something drastic and do it now. Once again, to the families, those who lost their lives, we hope you'll find comfort in the work that AMCU has done to make sure that your children are taken care of. And I understand that TABANE has come on board to look at some of what your children can benefit from bursaries and things like that. As they say in English, we have to be thankful for small mercies. Let them do something with those billions to make sure that your partners, your husbands, your breadwinners did not die in vain. Viva AMCU, viva!
Viva!
And viva JJ, viva! Viva JJ, viva!